Fatigue after traumatic brain injury. Fill in concussion, stroke, or the likes. An introduction to factors causing fatigue after brain injury and what you can start doing to resolve them. Hi, my name is Arjan Kuipers. The reason why I'm preparing a series of blogs and videos on this topic is because I have been very frustrated in my own career of over the last 30 years dealing with results of traumatic brain injury in my family, in my clients, in the clinic on a daily basis. And I have to be honest, even though we have been able to deal with a lot of problems like physical problems, pain problems as a result of neck injuries, vestibular balance issues after concussions, movement issues after stroke. I have to be really honest and tell that fatigue is one of the most difficult issues that we are dealing with and are the most complicated to resolve in a very quick way. So now I've said that, it's one of the reasons why I'm making this series. This is the introduction. I'm going to give an overview, not a detailed overview, but an overview of all the things that most likely play a role in the fatigue you're experiencing after a concussion, after a stroke, or other traumatic brain injury. Why an introduction? Because it would be too much to go into detail into every aspect. You will see there's a lot more videos and blogs coming on all the details. So what's the big deal? If you look at literature and if you look into daily clinical basis when you're dealing with post-concussed patients, post-stroke patients, then you see that the number one complaint is fatigue, energy problems, tiredness, fatigue, I pull them. Next to that, we see that a sensitivity to lights, sounds, or too many impressions is another biggie. It's also very difficult to resolve. We're going to dedicate a whole new series of videos and blogs to oversensitivity after traumatic brain injury separate. Then we are going to have a series about headache, because together with fatigue, oversensitivity, headaches are the big ones after traumatic brain injury. They are often lingering, lasting, easily coming back. I've experienced this in my own mother before I started all these studies to find better answers. And that is over 40 years. Almost 50 years ago. So fatigue is the topic of this series of videos and blogs, and we know not that much about fatigue after traumatic brain injury other than the logical explanation that having had a traumatic brain injury, if you're unlucky and you're one of the so many after, for example, a concussion that have lasting problems after a brain injury, then fatigue is the big one, and there's a lot of reasons for that. You have to compensate for what you cannot do. You know, cognitive functions are often affected. That will cost you a lot of energy. If there's underlying issues with your postural system, with your balance system, that will cause extra energy. In the overview, I will explain on the surface why that is and what the big topics are when you are dealing with fatigue. So, who are the main players in the causation of fatigue, other than the obvious that you're compensating for what you cannot do and that you maybe have headaches or tinnitus and that costs you a lot of extra energy? The number one, if we look at the research that comes out, and we see that in more and more studies, is energy crisis, not just in the start, but also a lasting energy crisis. Later on, I'm going to explain a little bit more about this and how it comes about. So, number one, energy crisis. Number two, and don't put me to the spot on which one comes first in your particular case. I don't know. It's just that we have learned from research, and more research is coming out that shows that there's an energy crisis going on, and that produces lasting fatigue. Other causation can be neuroinflammation. The immune system of the brain is activated by the traumatic event, and from then on the immune system is too easily activated. You cause a low-grade inflammatory status in the brain, which is never a good thing, and that causes you to not be able to act, but also to feel brain fog and fatigue. So that's another big one next to that there is an energy crisis. Then the number three is that's a very big word, neurovascular uncoupling. What does that mean? It means that when you want to activate a part of your brain, the coupling between the blood vessels that deliver the oxygen and the fuel for the area to function is not functioning anymore. It's malfunctioning. So you can go to the activity maybe a short while, but then your brain gives up, you get fatigue, you produce metabolic waste products, and it does not function as you were used to. So those three can be considered the big ones that play a role. For example, if you had a stroke, if you have lasting problems after concussion, these are the most likely players that are at least for part responsible for your fatigue. But there are other players as well. There are also physical components that play a role. For example, we know that, and we are going to spend a video, a blog, and it will be a big blog because there's a lot to tell about this. The interplay between the information of your postural system, especially the neck, your balance system, the vestibular system, and the eyes and the brain is disrupted. For some reasons, like a hard disk that gets a knock, it's malfunctioning. Your view of the world, your perception of the world and of yourself, it becomes distorted. And information is not placed into your brain and not at the speed that you are used to. And that can give problems ranging from dizziness to vertigo to an imbalanced feeling, weakness in the body, incapacity of your memory. Things are put in the brain at a different rate as that what is really happening, and that causes all kinds of problems. So that's an important one, and that takes a lot of energy, as well as that it can cause, and that is for the other series, oversensitivity to light, sound, inputs to the higher cognitive functions. Other thing that is often overlooked but is as important, we know that when something happens in the brain, you get a knock to the brain or you get a stroke, it will affect the blood-brain barrier, but it will also affect directly the gut. And most of you probably know that by now there's a lot of research out of there and calling your gut your second brain. There's a reason for it. Your gut microbiome has as much effect on your brain, apparently, as your brain has on your organs. So that is a very important one. So when the effect of the brain to the gut is disrupted and vice versa, because of a neck event to the head or in the head, like a stroke, then we see that a whole sequela of effects is put into place, where you see like there's like a downgrading of activity between the brain and the gut. We see that the immune system starts to do different things. We get a dysregulation of the brain. The brain does not receive the right messengers from the gut to function optimally. And yes, the brain receives not only signals through the nervous vagus, which is like sort of the highway between the gut and the brain, but it also doesn't receive certain chemical messages that are used for optimal fuel delivery, for optimal energy production from the gut. So there's another problem, whole different problem starting after brain injury in whatever shape or form, is that we see that it affects the organs, especially the gastrointestinal tract, not only blood supply, motility, secretions of fluids that is lost. We see a breakdown in the permeability of the gut wall. We see like a leaky gut that starts, and then we see a whole cascade of immunological problems that affect the blood-brain barrier, and that further aids the neuroinflammation, the inflammatory state of the brain that a lot of people are in when they have lasting problems after a traumatic brain injury. So we talked about energy crisis, we talked about neuroinflammation, inflammatory state caused by the immune system that is triggered by the traumatic event. And we talked about neurovascular uncoupling. There's less oxygen and fuel delivery through certain parts of globally in the brain. And then we see that there are physical aspects that can cause fatigue, especially from dysfunction from the interplay in neck function, vestibular function, eye functionality, and the brain, and the whole interplay gets disrupted, which has effects ranging from vertigo to pain complaints to cognitive complaints, slowing down of processing in the brain. And then we have a whole different order where, for example, the gastrointestinal tract gets disrupted and we get a whole cascade in negative consequences, for example, affecting the immune system. You may be prone to autoimmunity and those things, and then we lose the control of the brain onto the immune system. The immune system gets further triggered by this cascade of events, and then we may even trigger like autoimmune effects. So there's a lot going on, and you start to see that these are completely outside of the most obvious effects that we see in the brain, that we get disruption of some micro damage to the long tracts from the brain to the rest of the body, which are often not detected on standard scans. We completely bypass the effect it has on the eyes, on the jaw, on other physical functions. So these factors that I mentioned now come out of research that and are indicated to play a role in the causation of fatigue. Then, of course, is the category of psychological factors. And psychological factors are a little bit tricky to talk about. I have to confess, it's not my field of expertise, but it is obvious for me, it's obvious in the literature, that mindset, the way you perceive things, how you deal with negative consequences, of course, all play a role also in the causation of fatigue. And that is besides the fact that traumatic brain injury in itself, because we disrupt brain functions, we disrupt higher cognitive function in many cases, that it can have an effect on your psychological well-being, let alone the trauma that has caused the traumatic brain injury, which can cause a lasting effect. Having said that, in that respect, we see that people's status at the moment of the event play a huge role in the outcome. So three or four people can have the same event, they get the same knock on the head, and we see a completely different outcome. And that has to do with the status of the brain, how well the brain has developed, how well the brain is trained, how many highways you have in your brain. There's genetics involved, there's always genetics involved, even if you get these whole sequela of events after traumatic brain injury or not, more on that later. But the status of your brain at the moment of the traumatic brain injury, whether you had a lot of stress, more on that later, whether you had a traumatic upbringing, whether you already had a pre-existing disease, whether you had more brain traumata before the event, all play a significant role in the outcome. And it's not hard to see why that is. That is next to the fact that 60% of your brain is completely unique, not in its architecture per se, but how it is formed through all the life events that you have been through, and your genetics, of course. So genetics do play a role, as I just mentioned in the previous point. The genetics can, for example, determine that you're more vulnerable to negative events after the traumatic brain injury, and that recovery is more difficult. So that is just a fact. Although I cannot get from research that it is the predominant effect, probably the other things that we already mentioned and the combinations thereof. So genetics do play a role. We see in some families also that people are more prone to negative effects after traumatic brain injury, because apparently their genetics determine this. Now, the other thing, and that is coupled to the previous issue, yes, psychology does play a part, how you deal with negative events, how your outlook is on life, how determined you are, all these things, how motivated you are to recover, all these things play a role. Then there's something else. Negative emotions, stress, like overactivation of the stress systems, your fight or flight system, sympathetic nervous system, is also a huge factor in the causation of fatigue after traumatic brain injury. What do I mean with this? Traumatic brain injury will cause your primitive brain to become more active. When you develop, it is your new brain, the neocortex, that starts to control your more primitive brain, so you can control emotions, you have control over your life, can determine how you think about things that happen to you. That is your higher brain centers, that's your frontal lobe, comes into play. And apparently after traumatic brain injury, we see that this regresses, you go more to this primitive state where your brain is in retreats, goes in lockdown, and basically starts to protect itself and cannot ever come to the point where you were before, where you could deal with complex situations, complex problems, think about your situation, or when a lot of things happen at the same time, make sense of it. So the primitive brain, the limbic system, is activated. We get an overactivity of the sympathetic nervous system, and it basically means that all the circulation is directed to your primitive center brain, your hindbrain, and not to the new brain parts, the neocortex. So that's a very important thing. So dealing with stress and how you deal with psychological conditions, negative psychological conditions, is also determining how much fatigue you experience. Then the next big thing is sleep. Sleep cycle, the sleep quality in most people after a traumatic brain injury becomes affected. We know this from research. If sleep is affected, then you take away one of the biggest factors that is involved in repairing your brain, recovering energy in your brain. So sleep is also a big one. And then I've mentioned the most important factors in why fatigue comes about and is often lasting after traumatic brain injury. Now, knowing this will also mean that we have tools, we have something to hold on to, find tools to start your recovery. So, in summary, in this introductory video about fatigue after traumatic brain injury, concussion, stroke, other brain traumata, we can say that are the most common factors underlying fatigue, as we get it from research and we see it is in the clinic as well. And even if they are very hard to quickly solve, it seems that we have to focus on the energy at a cellular level. There's an energy crisis going on. We see that we have to deal with neuroinflammation, the immune system that gets triggered by the traumatic event. We see that we have to deal with neurovascular uncoupling. We have to improve circulation or the circulation and fuel delivery, oxygenation of certain brain parts or whole parts of the brain become compromised. And when you put a higher demand to your brain, you experience that you just cannot do that. We see that there is like a mechanical component to this. We see that the interplay between what happens in the neck, which is often disrupted and becomes unstable, gives the wrong input to the brain, which is the biggest input the brain has. The vestibular system, the balance system, eye functionality, and the brain's control. These are all intertwined, interlocked. This interplay becomes disrupted, costs you a lot of extra energy to tune back your orientation in the world, your self-perception, the way you process information becomes distorted, and you have to compensate this, which costs a lot of energy. Then we see other physical components like a disrupted gut-brain axis interplay, which affects the immunity, the sympathetic nervous system gets activated through these mechanisms. We see that the body becomes more pro-inflammatory, which we don't want because the brain is often already in a pro-inflammatory state. Then we see that the way you deal with negative adverse events plays a big role. We see that the sympathetic nervous system goes in overdrive. That's the limbic system with a password. And so we have to deal with these issues. So those are the biggies when we are dealing with fatigue after a traumatic brain event. And then you understand why it is so complex to control this very quickly. Because what we see, and this has been my big frustration for many, many years, and I only recently start to get a better grasp of it, that all these components make up a solution. So you have to look at all the components and the ratio in which these components are present will vary from person to person and will also be dependent on the state and the health and the condition of whoever gets the traumatic brain or suffers the traumatic brain injury at the moment of that event, and whether there has been previous episodes, other diseases, etc. So this is what we're going to talk about in next videos and next blogs. We're going to go deeper into the energy crisis at cellular level, where the mitochondria becomes disrupted. They go into cell defense mode. That will be one of the first other videos and blogs, is where we go into the why mitochondria do this, why they start to protect themselves, why they don't produce the energy that you need. When you put a higher demand on your brain, the energy is simply not there. You start to not lean burn, but you start to burn components that you should not be burning to get energy, and that is further making the situation even more complicated. So in the next videos, we're going to talk about energy crisis, we're going to talk about the neuroinflammation, we're going to talk about the neurovascular uncoupling, where oxygen and glucose are not going to the place where they should be. We're going to talk about physical things, we're going to talk about the interplay between the neck and the vestibular system, and the limbic overdrive, the sympathetic overdrive, etc., etc. So that you can expect. We will go not only deeper into the causation of these different factors, we will also go into what you can do, what we know from research and from clinical experience, what helps to alleviate the fatigue you're experiencing. Then in a whole new series that is made parallel to the fatigue series after traumatic brain injury, we're going to look into why there is this oversensitivity to light, sound, multiple inputs from the environment, and why this has so huge effect, and why it's so difficult to change this, what you can do to alleviate it. And then in a whole new series, we're going to go into the headache aspects after traumatic brain injury and sleep, etc. So there's a lot more to come. I hope this has given you some insights that you can start thinking about and maybe already start to think about different solutions for the problems you're experiencing. Thank you for now. My name is Arjen Kuipers and see you in the next video or blog.